Well, I am going to talk about Crossmark, and for those of you who are wondering after that sort of intriguing introduction what it is, this is where you'll find out. A couple of people asked me why I was giving this talk instead of Jeff, so I thought I would address that. Jeff has decided that he doesn't want anybody to think this was just a crazy idea anymore. And it's not a crazy idea, it's a great idea. And the fact is that Crossref staff, Crossref members, board members, people have been working very hard to make sure that Crossmark becomes something that is useful to all publishers and people in the scholarly community. And it's it's not just a Jeff harebrained scheme. It's a Jeff really good idea that's becoming reality, and people are working on it. So we're going to talk a little bit about what is Crossmark. I'm going to give you a demo. Internet sources willing. I do have some backup screenshots if that doesn't work. We'll talk about what it costs, how it works, what's the schedule, and what publishers actually need to do. Jeff went into some gory detail among the workshops yesterday. I'm not going to go into that much detail, but we can answer some questions if you have them. So, in the process of evaluating the prototype that we have for Crossmark, we did some focus groups with researchers and with publishers, and we also did some usability testing with researchers, which was really interesting. And one of the questions we asked researchers was, how can you decide whether you can trust this article, whether it's reliable? And so we watched researchers. It's kind of really painful to watch them and not be able to tell the answer. And they're kind of flailing around. Everybody says, well, I look at the author name to see if I know the person. And then they say, well, I look at the institution. If I don't know the author, then at least I know the institution, whether they do the kind of research I'm interested in, if I know somebody there, if that was my mentor. There are lots of different kinds of reasons there. Then they said, well, I look at how often something's been cited. Or is it on a reputable website? Do I recognize the journal? Some people said, oh, I look at the ratings or the comments, if those are features that are available on journal publishers. And we asked another question. We said, well, how does a researcher know if an article is up to date? So here's an article from the Science website. And I know that those of you in the back can't really read this. So this is, we're in the UK, and I understand that people in the UK really like quizzes. Right, so here's your quiz. How do you know if this article is up to date on the Science website? Does anybody know? Have there been any corrections to this article? On the left. Okay, yes, Science is really good, right there above the fold. This a correction to this article is available. And presumably you click here and you find the correction. Good. Okay. What about this article from Science? Have there been any corrections to this article? Well, we saw the other one, so we didn't see the little thing over there that says, I don't have Jeff's laser pointer, but it doesn't say there has been a correction, so let's assume in the absence of anything, there's no correction. Okay. Here's an article from BMC Genomics. Is this article up to date? The people in the front are the only ones who really have a shot here. Right, exactly. There's a correction that's been published for this article, okay? It's not in the same place, but it's above the fold. It's in a reasonable location. Well, here's another article from BMC Genomics. And it doesn't, I'll give you a hint, it doesn't say anything about a correction. So this one presumably doesn't have a correction. Here's an article from PLOS Medicine. Does this article have a correction? How many people think this article has a correction? How many people think it doesn't? It doesn't look like it has a correction. All right. So that's not really fair because you're not looking at the web page. Let's say you could scroll down. Does it have a correction? Okay, yeah, it does. But it's on the other side of the screen. So I wouldn't necessarily know that, and I think what we're seeing is that these are three very good publishers, very good reputations. They're all doing very good jobs at making sure that their corrections are stated on their home pages, but they're not consistently presented. This is a PDF. It's actually the same article. Has this been corrected? Well, we know it has been, right? We saw the correction. But there's nowhere on this PDF that says that it's been corrected. And I pulled this right off the website. So we talked to publishers about this kind of an issue, and we asked them, what are your concerns? And they said, well, one of our problems is that readers might choose unmaintained copies of articles. So you do a search on Google, you go to an author's webpage or an institutional repository somewhere, that's not the official version. That could have some negative impact on our subscription revenue if we're a subscription-based publisher. It could have a negative impact on our usage statistics, even if we're not a subscription-based publisher. We put a lot of effort into the functionality on our site. If readers are getting their documents elsewhere, then they're not able to take advantage of those things that we've built for them. Readers might cite the incorrect version. They might not cite the version of record. These are the things publishers told us that they were concerned about. In specific, they talked about what happens if somebody acquires something by interlibrary loan, or downloads a PDF, or prints their article. How do they know if there are corrections subsequent to that? And a number of publishers mentioned to us that specifically in medicine and related fields, it's very important that corrections be communicated to researchers. Okay. Now, I agree with Fred about the revenue source of Jeff's slides, so I've freely borrowed from them. Some of you have seen these before, and if so, I apologize, but they're good enough to see again. So one of the things we think about in terms of journal publishing is that when a journal article is published, it's finished forever. It's preserved in amber, but that's not really the way the web works. We know that there are lots of things that can change. We hope they don't happen too often, but they happen frequently enough to be concerned. And these are just some of the kinds of things that can happen to a final article. NISO had a journal article versions working group, and they came up with a set of recommended terms about the different stages of a journal. And the terms that are particularly interesting to us, because we're talking about things that are post peer review, are the version of record, enhanced version of record, corrected version of record. And while Crossmark doesn't necessarily use the NISO terms verbatim, the concept is really important. So the idea that there is a final version of a document deserves to rest in peace. So what is Crossmark and what does it have to do with all this? Well, Crossmark is a logo that identifies a publisher-certified or publisher-maintained version of record. And clicking on that logo tells you a couple of things. Well, it tells you if the copy you're looking at is maintained by the publisher. It tells you if there are any corrections. It tells you where the publisher-maintained version can be located via the DOI. And it includes any other optional metadata that the publisher may choose to include. And one of those things might be, like Fred talked about before, which would be funding sources. But there could be other things as well. So here's where I'm going to actually try to show you our prototype. If I click on this, this is just a page of some sample articles that we have. So my first article is from Wiley. It's a criminology journal, and we've attached a crossmark. And you can see that it says click to verify, and then the rollover says click to get updates and verify authenticity. Okay, so I'm going to click on that, and the internet gods are with us. And the crossmark pop-up box appears. So what you'll see here is a status tab. And it tells you right up front, this is a publisher-maintained version of the document, copy of this document. This is the DOI for that document. I can use that for citation. It tells me this copy of the document is current, and it has a little check mark. Okay? And then here's just a repeat of some of the metadata for the article. And it tells me that it's the version of record. Okay? So the trick is to get researchers to click on the crossmark. Let me give you another example. It's hard for me to see here. Let's say we're back at science again. Okay. And I've got the crossmark here. If I click on that, it brings up the crossmark tab. In this case, it is a publisher-maintained copy of the document. Here's the DOI to it. Ah, but the following update exists for this document with a DOI for the update. If I click on that, I'm actually taken to the correction. Okay. In addition, there's optional metadata here. This is non-bibliographic metadata that the publisher would choose to include. And in this case, we're given information about whether the document is peer-reviewed or not. Okay. So the Crossmark pop-up basically has information that allows the researcher to ascertain for themselves whether they want to trust this document. Okay. So here's another example. And this looks like it's from the BMC genomics site. In fact, it's not. The web domain here is gbuilder.com. So basically somebody has, Jeff, has screen scraped BMC genomics, and they have mocked up a page that looks very much like theirs. And if I click on this, I get this big warning message, no! Okay. This actually looks like a copy of the version of record, but I don't know anything about it because Crossmark doesn't know who gbuilder.com is. They don't know what that domain is. And the publisher has said to Crossmark, these are the domain names where I maintain the copies. And gbuilder wasn't one of them. So I'm getting this message. Okay. I do have a DOI to the actual authorized publisher maintained version. If I click on that link, it'll take me to the actual BMC site. And again, the corrections are there. The Crossmark data is living at Crossref, not on gbuilder.com. So it can pull up that data, even though this is not the current copy and this is not a maintained copy. Okay. And down here it tells me this is an unknown version. I don't know anything about it. Oops. Now Crossmark... I did it. Okay. So those are the major cases. I have a couple of others that I'd like to show you. And I think I have a screenshot for it. Oh, is the... I don't have a picture of this, but the other possibility is that, and Jeff has developed a plugin that's not working on my computer right now, is that you can include a Crossmark logo in search results. So for example, you do a Google search for something, and the Crossmark logo could be affixed on authorized domains where that document is. So you could tell visually from your search results whether something is maintained by the publisher or not. And again, we have a plugin that would do that, but presumably once Crossmark is widely used, then we could approach the search engines and other types of organizations that do searches with being able to incorporate this kind of data in their discovery tools. All right, so let's see if I can get back to Keynote. So I mentioned we did some usability testing on Crossmark, and it was a lot of fun, and it was really painful to watch. although it went really well, it's still, you know, there's a reason in focus groups they put you behind the mirror and tell you not to bang on it and yell at people. So we've decided that probably it makes more sense instead of saying click to verify to say something like click for updates, so it's very clear to people what it is they're looking for. And we're also testing logos. So in our demos and some of the material that you see about Crossmark, you may see different kinds of logos. And we haven't really landed on anyone, although these are the ones that are in contention. Another example, this isn't live, but this is a PDF. And you can see that you can actually attach a Crossmark to a PDF. And if I click on this, then it's actually going to open an HTML browser window that looks very much like that pop-up with the same data. And this, in some ways, is probably the most exciting response we got from all the people we showed this to. Because researchers tend to, when they're gathering information about a new project, they amass their PDFs. Maybe they keep them in a papers database or some other kind of software. Maybe they keep them on their hard drive. And it may be a while. It may be a month, it may be a year, it may be a week before they actually go and read it. And so they really liked the idea that you can click on the Crossmark in the PDF and ascertain what the current status is. And a number of the researchers that we talked to actually had war stories about how they had relied on an article that turned out to have changed. So this is not a fringe case. It does happen to people. Okay. So here's one more screenshot, and this one, Again, I apologize for those of you in the back who can't read very well. This is the record tab of a PLOS article. And in this case, we've actually included metadata on the funding source. This research was funded by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. So here's an example of what Fred Dilla was talking about, where you could actually incorporate funding information, grant numbers, where the data is deposited, what the licensing information is. In this particular case, we're looking at Creative Commons license, and the publisher might want to explain that. And then to the right there, we have the ability to put a link. So if you don't know exactly what that additional metadata is talking about, the reader could click on that and find out, you know, what exactly do we mean by it. Another example on the record tab could be that something had been cross-checked. And maybe not a lot of research know what cross-check is right now, but you could link on that information tab and say, oh, well, cross-check is this plagiarism screening service. So we know that that's happened. So as a result of this usability and focus group work that we've done, we're working to make those pop-up boxes a little bit more user-friendly, easier to read at a glance, refine the language, and to incorporate sort of more visual clues. So some of the recommendations that we're looking at is to put that icon sort of right up front, like green means this is good. And also, because most of the time when somebody clicks on a cross mark, there isn't going to be a correction. So we wanted to say, updates, if any, will be available here, so that if the first five times you click on a cross mark, you get kind of a no problem result, then at least you know what you would have gotten if there was a problem. Okay, so that's something that we're working on. Here's another example. So this people found that the big ugly warning message we had for the unauthorized website was legalese and not easy to read. Some people didn't want to actually read it or not. They knew there was a problem, but they didn't know what it was. We didn't actually tell people why they were getting the warning. So one of the recommendations from the usability study was, oh, well, let's tell people, hey, we don't know about this website. And there's a problem with the formatting of this, but that's one recommendation. And then another is, you know, we know this copy of the document's not current, so click on this DOI and you'll get the current document. So you may wonder, what does all this cost? Well, for current content, for publishers to deposit metadata at Crossref, for current content, and we define that as anything that's within the last 2 years, the same way we do for DOI deposits, it's 20 cents per item. And for backfile content, it will be 2 cents per item. And there are a number of rules that publishers would need to follow. One, of course, is that participation is optional. As Jeff mentioned, this is a new service, just like cross-check and cited by linking and some of the other new things that we've come out with. Reference linking is only the only real mandatory service at Crossref. So you don't have to participate if you don't want to. Of course, we hope that you'd be interested. If you participate in Crossref, CrossMark, then you have to maintain your metadata, just as you would have to maintain your metadata for DOIs. So if you have a correction, you got to deposit the information about the correction. It kind of goes without saying, but I thought I'd say it. You have to keep it up to date. Publishers would need to adhere to a certain number of logo guidelines. So here's a tension. You know, publishers spend a lot of time and effort designing their websites, and they don't want something that's too intrusive. And yet our usability testing shows us that unless it's consistent across multiple sites, then people are unlikely to click on it. So this is not necessarily going to be easy to resolve, and we're going to spend a lot of time making sure that those guidelines are workable from both angles. Participants would need to link to a CrossMark policy page on their site and assign that page a DOI so it explains what their policies are with regards to CrossMarks. And anything, almost anything with a CrossRef DOI could have a CrossMark. So it doesn't have to be peer-reviewed literature. So here's a sort of a laundry list of things that publishers would have to do. So they would have to deposit CrossRef metadata, and that could happen either with their CrossRef deposit, their DOI deposit, or it could happen afterwards. The intention is to modify the schema so that it's one deposit, it's not two separate deposits. for Crossmark and Crossref. Keep that metadata updated, as I mentioned. Display the Crossmark logo on your HTML publication pages, and there's a, I was going to say there's an app for that, but I don't think that was quite accurate. So there's a widget for that. And then add Crossmark metadata to PDFs, and there's a tool for that. And then add linked Crossmark logos to PDFs, and there's this PDF mark thing for that. So we're working on tools to make all these things easy. I should probably have mentioned in the rules that it's not, you know, if you decide to participate, it would not be required to attach Crossmarks to all of your back files, although, again, it would be recommended. So it would just be current information that you'd be asked to deposit. And then the other thing, and this is not really a small matter, after I've talked to a couple publishers about it, you have to decide what kind of optional metadata is worthwhile, and you have to make sure that you have it collected in a in an organized and databaseable kind of a format. So you might want to include funding sources, but if you don't have a field somewhere that's searchable that you could output to Crossmark, then you have some work to do probably on your end before that could happen. So when is all this going to happen? Starting in December, a few publishers will go live with a pilot, putting real Crossmarks on real journal pages. And then if everything goes well, we'll plan for a launch where everybody can join in April, and probably there will be an increasing number of people participating between those two time periods. So that's all I have. I'm willing to entertain questions, and we have a lot of backup if you have anything really difficult. So, yeah.
Bob Campbell, why do you use the word copy rather than version in the metadata? Because it's not strictly a copy if it's different.
There's a difference between copy and version. So a copy refers to sort of where it is. You might have a copy on your hard drive, and there might be a copy on the publisher's website. The version has to do with where in the publication process it was.
I still think you need to look at that language.
Yeah.
Because you refer to copy of document. It might be more powerful to see this version of the document.
Okay.
If somebody's coming in to look at it.
All right.
What's the remedy
if there is a legal version? Right. So we're not saying anything about the legality of whether these things exist or not. And in fact, some of the examples that I used, like PLOS is an open access journal, and they encourage people to republish their journal articles in other locations. All we're saying, so it's not illegal, and unauthorized is even really not quite the right word. The right word is a site where the publisher has not indicated that it's maintained. So, for example, if a publisher said it's fine for authors to put things on their homepages or an institutional repository, but the publisher doesn't commit to update corrections, errata, you know, whatever else might happen to that thing on the author's website or in the institutional repository, then the Crossmark would say, here's the authorized version of the document. Here's the link to the authorized version of the document. The publisher would let Crossmark know that the author's website was maintained. Yeah. So it's the publisher who controls that. So for an example that I could think of that would be likely is publishers license with aggregators. And so if EBSCO agreed to update the metadata and keep their corrections updated and things like that in the same way that the publisher does on their own site, then EBSCO could be a Crossmark domain. Okay, I don't know how realistic it would be for a publisher to commit to maintain individual author websites, but if they wanted to, Crossmark would let them. They would just have to submit that domain name.
Readers would find useful would be correspondence relating to a publication or a paper. So if there's follow-up correspondence relating to it, which might query that, or follow-up correspondence to the correspondence by the author, that would be very helpful.
So in other words, not just updates, but related articles.
Yeah.
Yeah, and some publishers actually do have that on their websites. Jeff?
Can I well known ones like Errata, Corrigenda. But of course, various disciplines have very specific things that they need to report, like protocol debates or letters of concern. Every place we go, we keep encountering new things like this. And in some cases, it might be that they actually, if there are letters pertaining to an article in a particular discipline, that's an important fact to say, and that is a kind of update that people want to alert readers to. So to accommodate that. But we expect it to vary from discipline and publisher to publisher.
Any other questions?
Is this extensible to e-books where, okay, you may not want to, on an e-book, if you've got illegal copies out on the web, this might be able to say, well, it would maybe warn somebody that it could be downloading an illegal copy.
Right, so I think one important point here is that, well, there are a couple of points. First is, all the examples that I gave you were journal articles, but there's no reason why you couldn't use this for book content. The second is that Crossmark is not an attempt to provide any kind of DRM. So we don't prevent people from making copies. But yes, you could certainly, if someone copied something illegally, put it on an unauthorized site and kept the Crossmark on it, the Crossmark would point to the authorized or the publisher, I should say the publisher maintained version of it. And it wouldn't really say anything about enforcement or copyright infringement or anything like that. If the publisher wanted to attach optional metadata about the licensing, they could do that. But that would sort of be up to the publisher. Does that make it clear? Okay. Anybody else? All right, great. Well, I hope you will all have an opportunity to participate come next April. Thank you.